Good morning, everyone. I'd like to say my name's Michael Ponterio from the law firm of Lipsitz, Ponterio and Comerford. And first of all, on behalf of our firm, I'd like to thank everyone who's here today. Thank you for taking the time to come here. I hope you find that this seminar is helpful and informative to all of you. We have a number of well-qualified speakers from our firm that are going to talk to you, in addition to myself. And since 1985, it's over, hard to believe, 38 years ago, my partner John Lipsitz and I have been representing workers and their families who have unfortunately contracted various asbestos-related diseases. Mostly, we've represented people throughout Niagara County, from Hooker Chemical, Durez, right throughout all those plants. And other attorneys say, well, how can you guys do the same thing over and over? Don't you get bored or whatever? And, you know, just the opposite. You know, we've, through these years, through 38 years, have met some of the nicest, kindest families. And each family has a unique story about how they were exposed to asbestos and how they met. And we pride ourselves, John and I, in coming to people's homes, sitting down with them in their kitchen, meeting them, getting to know them. And that's really very important and something that we really enjoy doing. Hopefully you never need to retain us, but if you do, that's one of the things that we offer. And it's important to get to know your clients. We come to you. You don't have to come to us. That's a big advantage that we have over, like, say, a New York City firm or out-of-state firms. They may come in the first time, but we come and see you a number of times. And it's geared now so that if you have to have a lawsuit, most of the stuff is done right at your home. Testimony is taken remotely from your kitchen table or couch, and others will explain that. But that is something that we've done throughout 38 years. We've made a decision not to have a mass market of cases where you're just a number. We know all our clients, and we know their family members, and we see them all the time. Fortunately, some of us even grew up. I grew up in Tonawanda. My grandfather worked for over 30 years at Durez. My dad worked during high school, worked at Durez, so I got to know all the families. And it's been a privilege, and I mean that. It's a real privilege to represent these families, and they're part of your community. And with that, I just want to tell you we have a staff of 40 people. I'll show you some of the. These are our attorneys, and one of the younger attorneys asked one time, well, how do you know when you've been to a client's house enough? And the other attorney said, well, when the family dog stops barking when you're at the front door. And with all kidding aside, that happens quite frequently. One time we're taking the witness's testimony, the actual client's testimony in his living room. He worked at Niagara Mohawk Huntley Steam Station. And as I'm asking the questions on a video in his house, his family dog jumps up on my lap, you know, and starts wagging its tail. And it's, but that's something that the personal nature of these cases is something that they're very sad. Because, you know, family members, if they get an asbestos disease, some of them are very serious and dangerous. But, you know, we do our best, and we try. And we have a great staff, and like I said, we grew up in this area, and we know a lot of the people, and it's more than just a job. It's something that we do, and we take seriously. With that, I'm going to introduce John Comerford, my partner, and he'll speak. Thank you.
Good morning. I want to keep a lot of these presentations tight and to the point. I think if Lincoln can deliver the Gettysburg Address in 2 minutes, we should be able to deliver this in a short way. Thank you for coming. My name is John Comerford. I've been representing people with mesothelioma for almost 28 years. I had my 28th anniversary with the firm would just occur, and I'm pretty boring. I've been married to the same person for 28 years. I've been with the same firm for 28 years. I've got five kids. And I think when you're looking to hire a law firm, you want to hire someone who's steady. You have enough going on in your life. And I like to think if you come to us, we're going to keep things simple, because what's going on in your life is probably pretty complicated, and you don't need to add to that. I'm from Niagara County. I grew up in Lewiston. My father and his family are from 79th Street, so they take a right out of this hotel, and that's where they grew up. My dad was a physician with Dr. Deister and his crew for over 50 years or 40 years here in Niagara Falls. So I want to spend a few minutes with you about what we do and the legal remedies for asbestos disease. And you'll hear a lot of the medical, and I don't want to spend much time on it, but for the most part, there's two types of asbestos-related diseases: cancer, mesothelioma, lung cancer, and then asbestosis. I'm going to talk as if you've got probably a more serious disease, either mesothelioma or lung cancer, which can be a terminal condition and is only from asbestos. You have three primary claims for asbestos-related disease, and they're all different. And our firm's been working on these for well over 30 years. And what's important is to hire a law firm that has a grasp of this and can help you understand how these interact and how these work. The first is a lawsuit. The lawsuit does not target your employer if you have an asbestos-related disease. It targets usually the manufacturers and distributors of asbestos. Under New York law, if you have an asbestos-related disease, this is the lawsuit. You can get a trial date within 12 months. And I know to some of you, that doesn't seem like a big deal. Well, the average civil lawsuit in America takes about 5 years to resolve. There's a provision under New York law that allows you to get a trial date within 12 months. There's a local judge assigned to these cases. And we've been very successful in moving these in a timely fashion. And I think that's important because time is not always on your hands. You want to have these cases resolved while you're alive to give you some peace. The second claim is a lot of these companies, you've heard some of these names, Johns Manville, Owens Corning, they're bankrupt. And these bankruptcies they entered into are phony baloney. They're trumped up for corporate America. It's terrible what they've done. But some are in place. We have to deal with it. Money's been put aside in these trusts. We have a large crew in my office that sort of navigates around these trusts to maximize the value for them. And these are huge companies that we have to deal with. Johns Manville, Owens Corning, United States Gypsum, National Gypsum, W.R. Grace. And that is an area of recovery for you that's separate and distinct from the lawsuit. The third claim here, and we have a woman here named Katie Dibble who really focuses on this in our office. If you die from a work-related disease, most lawyers don't even know this. It's crazy to me. Even though you're retired, your spouse is entitled to what's called widow benefits under workers' compensation under New York law. That claim can pay anywhere between $400 to $600 a week, tax-free to someone. I think they're important claims. Our competitors, to be honest with you, from the New York City area, they don't even file these workers' compensation claims because it's beneath them. There's not enough money. But we live here in this community. Last time I checked, $300, $400, $500 a week to someone on a fixed income is a lot of money. And I also know a lot of you, even though the lawsuit doesn't allow you to sue the lawsuit doesn't allow someone to sue their employer. But I think everyone in this room realizes that if you get up every morning and you go to work, as a loyal employee for 30, 40, 50 years, and you develop a disease because of that work, the employer should be held to some level of responsibility. And all we have is workers' compensation. It's an administrative claim. We have a staff that works on those cases every day. And to me, it's an important claim. We're proud that we do them. And it's a backstop financially to so many people, the workers' compensation claims. We've talked about the administrative claims and how important they are. The lawsuit is important because you need to hire a lawyer that has had cases, if you can, out of that job site. There's so much that we've learned. Every lawsuit we do, whether it's Hooker Chemical, Carbon Graphite, Carborundum, and go on and on in Niagara County, Ashland Oil, I know that's in Erie County. But what you have to do is target the manufacturers and suppliers of asbestos that caused your disease. And I know what a lot of you are thinking. How in God's name am I going to remember something that took place 40 years ago? Well, if you hire a lawyer who's had countless cases out of that job site, you can and will remember how and where you were exposed to asbestos. We've got to shake the dust off. And guess what, gentlemen? Most of the people that get this disease are gentlemen. You owe it to your wife and your kids who have put up with you for 30, 40, 50 years to make sure we hold these companies responsible. We can do that. I mean, I always tell this story quickly. Going back in time is hard. I was once retained our firm by someone who was a flexographer. I bet you there isn't one of you that knows what a flexographer is. I didn't. A flexographer is someone who works in the printing business. They make packaging in the printing business for food. And this gentleman told me, Mr. Comerford, I know I have mesothelioma, but I wasn't exposed to asbestos. I don't know why you're here. I said, you were, because you have a disease only caused by asbestos. Well, as I'm driving home from his house, I Google flexographer, and I found a library at RIT, Rochester Institute of Technology. They have a library on flexography. So I go in. And this gentleman was a flexographer for almost 40 years. I find a journal called Flexography and Us. Really exciting stuff, right? I start going through this journal, and I see companies selling and distributing and advertising matrix asbestos board for flexographers. And guess who's in one of the articles working on the product? My client, who said he was never exposed to asbestos. And here's the problem. So many of these companies, when they sold and they distributed asbestos, they didn't warn it as asbestos. They didn't market it. They didn't inform you about this. So I put this onto a 3x2 foot poster board, and I marched into his house a few days later peacocking, saying, yeah, you were exposed. Do you recognize this mug in the picture? And it was just unbelievable. If you're willing to do the homework and you're willing to dig, you will find how and where you were exposed to asbestos. But it's really helpful when, and I'll target Hooker Chemical a little bit, the number of men and women who've developed disease out of that facility and the amount of information we have learned from that, that's something that we hope we can use and share with you to help in your, hopefully not, but a potential case down the road. This is interesting, this two disease rules. Under New York law, you have to commence an action within 3 years. Whether it's a slip and fall at tops, a car accident, if it's a personal injury case, you have to commence it within 3 years. Well, I'm sure some people in this room probably have evidence of what's called asbestosis on their lungs. That's what they call pleural plaquing. The 3 years officially starts there, but there's an exception. If you end up getting cancer down the road, and let's hope you don't, whether it's lung cancer or mesothelioma, the statute of limitations starts over because it's a separate, distinct disease. John Lipsitz and Mike Ponterio went to our appellate courts to fight for that, and that law was established. And that was done decades ago, and that's really important because I know some people, when they're diagnosed with what they call markers on the lungs, they don't want to bother dealing with lawyers, they don't want to do anything. But then if they get cancer, I'm always concerned the statute's going to run. So if something happens and you have these markers on your lungs, please call us, and then we can discuss with you some of the intricacies of this. So Paul Brodeur died 10 days ago. I was Facebook friends with him. He published a book called Outrageous Misconduct, and I'm not talking about my college years, okay? This was a book about the asbestos industry, and it really detailed their behavior, and it was reprehensible. And I always talk about, we get into all these details about statute of limitations, bankruptcy claims. You know what the heart of the matter is? These companies absolutely knew they were going to kill people. It's that simple to me. And they decided not to warn. They decided not to inform you. And Paul Brodeur, I think it was around 1977, 78, started to write about this in the New Yorker magazine to call this out. And then he put this book together. And there's a number of lawyers that we work with throughout the country. Bobby Hatton's one. He's in this book. The fights they took on to eventually turn the tide. Because when these cases were initially filed in the mid-70s, the injured workers were on the losing side. And Michael and John started doing this around 1985, 86. And we've been doing very well, but I don't want you to think these cases are easy or simple. They're complicated. Here's one example. A lot of people have heard of the Bendix company. Bendix is a manufacturer of brake linings. They're owned by a huge company called Ally Signal that owned chemical plants like Buffalo Color in South Buffalo. They made, for example, large coke ovens of Bethlehem steel. You ever go down Route 5 and you see those huge coke ovens? I mean, their tentacles run long and deep throughout the asbestos industry. This is 1966. And this isn't a parking lot attendant. This is their director of research. He writes this memo. It was internal. And he says, they're talking about asbestos and what they should do. It's 1966. This is 2 years before I was born. My answer to the problem is, if you've enjoyed a good life while working with asbestos products, why not die from it? There's got to be some cause. Does that look like a company that's here to help you? That's caring and thoughtful. And so we have gathered a lot of these documents on these companies, knowledge documents, because if you don't have what I call this sort of weapon in reserve when you're negotiating these cases, they're not going to respect you. So we have lots of information. And then the other thing I want to touch on, a lot of people will stop me when they see me like at Tops and say, you know, you guys are a bunch of ambulance chasers. I don't think these companies knew anything. Like, we'll hear that. I go, really? Really? Well, here's what New York law is on this subject. If you manufacture, sell, or distribute a toxin, a potential toxin, you've got to research it, study it, see if there's a problem. And then if there is, before you sell it, you owe a duty and obligation to share that information with what we call Joe Lunchbox, the person who's working with the product. That's fundamental New York law. You have to research, is there a hazard? And if there is, you better tell the worker about the potential hazard, the deadly consequences of it. So how is that done? Under New York law, and Michael and John Lipsitz in a case called George Fuselitex made this law almost 20 years ago. It was the first case in New York State that really crystallized this proposition, and that is you can go to the library, any medical library, and do you remember before the internet they had the card catalogs? They call that for medical school, the Indicus Medicus. You look up to see when asbestos, mesothelioma was first mentioned. Because if you have a duty to research and then share that information, you start off by looking in what's in the literature. That's what these doctors are bound by. Not what's being, you know, discussed at the barbershop. What's in the medical literature journals and when was it published? It started, believe it or not, in the late 1800s. By 1930, it was fundamentally established in all the medical scientific journals that asbestos is linked to lung cancer. And then the study started to come out more and more. By the mid-60s, if you went to UB Medical School, you could look this up, mesothelioma was absolutely linked to asbestos exposure. It was published in JAMA, Journal of American Medical Association, which is the number one journal that doctors all rely upon. And then it was published in the New York Times. So this isn't a rumor or innuendo. The other things I want to address, and I think this is important, whenever anyone thinks of mesothelioma, they think of tradespeople working with asbestos, right? They think of a gentleman going into a steel plant, a refractory, a chemical plant, and being exposed to asbestos. What's so important to realize is, and it's not in the screen, but first of all, we have seen an epidemic of women and daughters exposed to asbestos by laundering their father's or mother's clothing. They call that dirty clothes cases. Ton of those, unfortunately. The other thing we have seen for environmental exposure, people who live near and around asbestos plants are getting mesothelioma. And we've done a ton of research and studies. We usually have to hire, believe it or not, experts in weather to show how asbestos was being processed from a plant and where it was going. The other thing we've seen the last 5 years is cosmetic talc. Johnson & Johnson, Clubman. These cosmetic talcs absolutely had asbestos in it. Talc is really another name for asbestos. When OSHA was passed in 1972 and ultimately signed by Nixon, was the president when OSHA was passed, talc was considered asbestos under the OSHA regulation. At the last minute, it was struck, in part because Nixon was very, very close with the Vanderbilt family, who was the number one seller and distributor of industrial talc at the time. So that was removed. And that removal from OSHA gave the talc industry about a 30-year reprieve from being looked at. But there's now been a huge epidemic of cosmetic talc having asbestos. And in 2019, the FDA, on their own, sampled a number of Johnson & Johnson baby powder products, and it was loaded with asbestos, the recall. And Johnson & Johnson now, if you go to Tops and you want to buy a baby powder, it says cornstarch on it. Doesn't say talc anymore. So in the asbestos medical scientific areas, they used to say some mesotheliomas are idiopathic. Idiopathic is a fancy word that means unknown cause. So when a lot of women who were getting mesothelioma, they couldn't explain it. It's because we were tricked. If you look at J&J baby powder and you go back into their internal documents and records, they knew by around 1930 that their talc was laced and contaminated with asbestos. They had it. And just think about this for a minute. What is J&J, this iconic product, primarily being used for? To powder the butts of infants, the most vulnerable population you can imagine. And J&J absolutely knew that babies were being poisoned with asbestos. And they filed a phony bankruptcy, by the way, that was just thrown out by our Third Circuit. So the J&J story is just starting. And I'm sure if I did, how many people, either their mother, their siblings, used J&J baby powder in their home?
Everybody.
Like, who didn't, right? I'm now going to pass the baton to John Lipsitz. I think I violated my I better be short speech. When this is over, if anyone wants to talk, I probably need a psychiatrist. I find this stuff so interesting. So I talk about it 24/7. So if you need to talk, if you have questions, reach out to me. And hopefully you'll never need us.
Is there a psychiatrist in the house?
Yeah.
I am going to be pretty short. And I just wanted to give you an idea of the scope of the problem in Niagara County as opposed to other parts of the country. The rate of mesothelioma, that cancer that's uniquely connected to asbestos exposure in Niagara County, is many, many times higher than just about any other county in the United States. If you look, for example, at the general population in the country, I mean, there are estimates of 1 in a million people in the general population developing mesothelioma in any given year. But at Durres, for example, they're probably getting close to about 100 documented cases of mesothelioma among both the workforce and the neighborhood residents. And that's in a, you know, that if you look at North Tonawanda, I'm trying to remember the population, but it's about 20 or 25,000. So 100 out of that small population is a lot. And it's an indication of how widespread and intense exposure to asbestos was over the years throughout Niagara County. I have these slides, and I'm going to try to use them just to show you some of the work sites, which you're more familiar with than I am. Let's see. How's that? Well, that's Hooker Chemical in Buffalo Avenue. Many people work there. Many of you here probably did. There were about 1,300 people employed there, I think probably at the height of production at one point. And I'll go back to Hooker Chemical in a minute. This is the DuPont plant. I think this is the picture of the DuPont plant in Niagara Falls. I may be wrong, and somebody here could correct me. This is, you know, also, this is variously known as spear carbon, Airco spear, and carbide graphite. And they made carbon electrodes here, and I'll talk about that in a minute, too. But they also used a tremendous amount of asbestos, especially in a department known as the mass bake. And so here, for example, if you were working with coal tar pitch, which was the primary component of carbon electrodes, you would have been exposed to coal tar pitch volatiles and asbestos, both of which are potent causes of lung cancer. This is the mass bake, which is at carbide graphite. You can see how asbestos coats these ovens that were used to bake the electrodes. This is the Carborundum plant. There were grinding wheels made here with asbestos materials. Union Carbide, actually, there were a number of Union Carbide facilities in the area, including Lindy in the town of Tonawanda in Erie County. And we've had a lot of experience with all of the Union Carbide plants, including Lindy, where, by the way, the Manhattan Project, part of the Manhattan Project occurred there, and about 15% of the uranium that was processed for the bomb went through Lindy, and a lot of people did get sick as a result of that, and that was top secret. So a lot of the people that worked there were told, you can't talk about this. OLIN MATHIESON, I believe it was one of the chlorine plants, and of course they made a lot of chlorine at Hooker too. Well, I think this is just another view of the Buffalo Avenue plant. And Goodyear, like all of these plants, had a lot of hot process pipes that were covered with asbestos insulation, which of course is, you know, everybody has, you might have it in your basement. You've seen it on pipes all over the place over the years. So the hot process pipes in Goodyear and elsewhere were all coated with this kind of material. That's the kind of material that also got construction workers sick, because a lot of them were involved in constructing buildings, insulating the lines, and also construction workers were particularly vulnerable to materials that were sprayed on the decks of buildings to fireproof them, and also bowling alleys to soundproof them, and indoor swimming pools to soundproof them. This is the Durres plant. It's an aerial shot. It was taken, I think, in like 1948. And that kind of brings me, well, let me get, Norton Labs is a location in Lockport where they made plastic molding compound, and an ingredient of that to strengthen and harden the plastic is asbestos. Anybody that works at Durez would have been involved in making some of the plastic molding compound that was sold to Norton Labs, where they made pieces for industry. So let me just go back for a minute. If I, let's see, Goodyear. Just with respect to Goodyear, over the last 3 to 4 decades, I've been involved in litigation at Goodyear. My firm has been. I've worked closely with out-of-town counsel, who was very familiar with the processes at Goodyear. The rate of bladder cancer there, which is unrelated to asbestos exposure, is huge, and it's due to exposure to ortho-toluidine, which is a chemical that was used in the rubber industry for strengthening and hardening and vulcanizing rubber. They also used vinyl chloride there, which is a very potent cause of a very particular kind of liver cancer. It's rare, but when you see it, it's because of exposure to vinyl chloride. So we have information on all of this that I'm talking about, thousands and thousands of pages that we've stored. They're all retrievable. It's all material that we use in litigation. I don't have perfect knowledge of any of this, but collectively with the other lawyers in the firm and the computerized information database that we have, we've all got access to it. Let's see. I think I'm going the wrong way again. Let's see. Okay. That's probably what I wanted to say about those slides. I mean, Niagara County is particularly vulnerable because, you know, there was a huge buildup of industry after World War II, and it was aided by the availability of inexpensive power. We also had a lot of innovative engineers and chemists and highly skilled people developing innovative manufacturing processes and technology. And so that was great, but part of the downside, of course, is the proliferation of harmful products like asbestos that were used at all these various locations. At chlorine was a big, you know, product manufactured in Niagara Falls and at the Hooker plant on Buffalo Avenue until quite recently. And I know many of you are familiar with that and the cell renewal process. And there was a major expose in the ProPublica, published by ProPublica a year and a half ago, about that. The carbon electrodes, by the way, the chlorine manufacturing is locally was many ways sparked by the abundance of natural resources and particularly cheap electrical power. The carbon electrodes that were made at Carbide Graphite, they were used in the steel industry, and there was a lot of steel industry in the area. The materials that were made at Goodyear Tire Rubber Company, part of the automobile industry. There's a lot of other associated automobile industry in the Buffalo area. And at those plants, people were exposed to asbestos as well, principally because of the use of insulation materials on steam pipes. That's really what I wanted to say, just to kind of set the stage, but I think my colleagues have already pretty well explained the kinds of exposures and disease that we are involved with in representing people in lawsuits. For most of the past, well, I go back with Mike Ponterio to 1985 when we first started working together, and I spent a lot of time in deposition rooms and in people's houses, as did Mike and all my colleagues. More recently, I've spent more time in courts arguing cases about the shape of the law and what should be what the appropriate principles should be for applying the law having to do with the failure to warn and the responsibility of manufacturers to put safety first and to put people before profits. So thank you. And I don't know who I'm turning it over to next, but Michael, tell me. Thanks.
I just briefly talk about the various asbestos-related diseases and how it's evolved over the past 35 years, the patterns that we've seen and how it's initially involved just workers who directly handled asbestos. Then it expanded into people that worked on the job site that never really handled asbestos directly, but were exposed to the airborne fibers. Then it went to the family members of the workers who came home with asbestos on their work clothes. They started to develop asbestos disease. And now we've seen the pattern where people that live around the neighborhoods where asbestos was used as an ingredient, it would escape into the air. The winds would carry it into the neighborhoods, and neighborhood people were developing disease. And at the start, you probably know some of these people. At Hooker Chemical, one of the first people we represented was a guy named Teddy Skiba. He was a guy that worked directly with asbestos. Most recently, another guy, Bob Kiedrowski. He was a longtime worker at Hooker Chemical. At Carborundum on Buffalo Avenue, there was a guy, Stephen Giannini. He developed an asbestos cancer. His wife, Kathy, who laundered his clothes, just passed away from an asbestos cancer also. You see these patterns. If you look at carbide graphite, I think one of the first, I know the first families we represent was a guy named Aubrey Ward a number of years ago if you worked at carbide graphite. And then there was a guy, he was infamous, in if you ever were associated with carbide graphite, a guy named Lenny Palumbo, who had an asbestos cancer. He continued down the line. Durez, the numbers of people are too numerous to mention, but guys like Ronnie Cromer, even the president of the union there, Bob DePiro, they died of asbestos cancer. And DuPont, example, a family named George Ashley, he passed away from mesothelioma. And one of his co-workers who was very knowledgeable was a guy named Jan Reeves. So we learned about asbestos really disease from working on all these cases of all these people, principally in Niagara County. And it's mind-boggling. It really is that, as John Lipsitz said, one of the highest rates of asbestos disease in the country is right in our own backyard here in Niagara County from the use of asbestos. It's hard to fathom that that it hits so hard in this area. But asbestos, you know, the asbestos fibers, they're indestructible. That's what made them so important in industry and making products. And that indestructibility is what led to, when it gets into your lungs, it stays there until it disrupts the cells and starts a cancerous or non-cancerous process. And the asbestos fibers, the ones that injure people, you really can't even see them with your naked eye. They're so small, but they become airborne. They can travel several hundred feet. I mean, someone can be working on an asbestos product. A couple hundred feet away, people are exposed and can breathe it in through your nose or mouth. It becomes embedded in your lung. And one of the things about asbestos, it's not like an acid that burns your skin if you're exposed to it, or it itches like fiberglass. It really has no offensive qualities so that a worker doesn't even know he's being exposed unless the companies that make the products warn the workers, warn people that there's asbestos in the product and that it can cause harm. And that's really why this litigation developed because the companies never warned on a timely basis, never even let, in many instances, people know that the products contained asbestos as a component. And another kind of cruel thing about this disease that we've learned over the years, you breathe it in, and it's not like a cold where you catch a cold in a few days after you're exposed. It lays dormant in your lungs up to 50, 60 years later. So that oftentimes we see people that get an asbestos cancer and look at the records, and the doctors will say, no known asbestos exposure or no known exposure, because people don't think when they get sick today, something that happened 60 years ago could have caused it. But that's the nature of asbestos disease. And those are such the background of how people are exposed. There's really non-cancerous asbestos diseases. And the first is, it's called pleural plaque or pleural thickening. And it's a thickening, it's non-cancerous on the lining of your lung that can become calcified, hardened. But fortunately, in most overwhelming majority cases, it doesn't cause any breathing impairment, the pleural plaque itself. But it's a marker. If you have a chest x-ray and they see pleural plaque, it's a sign you've had substantial asbestos exposure. You know, and we usually see that. Doesn't mean you're going to get cancer, but it's a caution that you've been exposed and it's in your lung and you've got to be careful. You've got to see your doctor every couple years to get monitored for a chest x-ray. That's the first type of non-cancerous disease. Second, which is a bit more serious, is asbestosis. And that is, the experts tell us, your lung is like a wet sponge, a porous wet sponge. And inside each person's lung, there's air sacs where you breathe in, the air goes through the air sacs, you breathe in oxygen, you exhale carbon dioxide. Well, asbestos fibers cause a scarring inside your lung, in that lung tissue. And the experts, they tell you that that wet lung turns into like a leather. That's how hardened your lung can be. And it can compromise your ability to breathe. And it's a progressive disease. It's non-cancerous, but it can progress. And that's a second type of disease inside your lung tissue that we've seen with people exposed to asbestos. The most serious of diseases are lung cancer. And most people, I mean, let's face it, back in the 40s, 50s, even doctors advertised smoking cigarettes. If you smoked cigarettes and were exposed to asbestos, it's just like taking gasoline and a lighted match, put them together. The increase of getting lung cancer from people that had smoked and were exposed to asbestos is 5,000% increased risk over people that never smoked and never were exposed. It's a really substantial combination and a lethal one. But if you get a lung cancer, Roswell's right in our backyard, if you get it early enough, they can detect it and they can do a surgery to remove that tumor, and hopefully it doesn't spread and you can go on with your life. They call it a lobectomy. They also have chemotherapy and radiation, but anybody that has had it, I mean, chemotherapy is, the goal is to kill the cancer cells. Unfortunately, it kills all your good cells too and can have a lot of side effects. The most dreaded of all asbestos diseases is called mesothelioma. And that's a cancer exclusively, almost exclusively caused by asbestos on the lining of your lung. Cigarette smoking has nothing to do with it. And if you have a cancer like that, it's very serious, and they're trying to come up with treatments, surgery to remove a lung, it's rough surgery. Most recently, immunotherapy. That's taking it where they don't destroy cancer cells, they inhibit and preclude cancer cells from growing. So people are, hopefully the medical field is optimistic that these cancers can be put under control. But those are the broad base of asbestos diseases. And, I'm going to be short because, God forbid, no one ever has to suffer from an asbestos disease. But if you do, you have time limitations and can avail yourself and your family of legal remedies, which you would very much deserve. So with that, I'm going to introduce my partner, Joe Kramer, and he has some very important things to discuss with you, and then we'll have lunch. Thank you.
Thanks.
Nobody ever wants to speak, be the last guy to speak before lunch, so I'm going to try to be brief. I guess they either thought I would be the most entertaining or just throw me to the wolves. Either way, I have a few comments for you. I want to talk to you about the actual lawsuit. Now, I think many of you, if you've seen some of the, I guess, our competitors' ads, they kind of create an illusion that there's been a class action lawsuit, that there's a big pot of money out there somewhere, and all you got to do is reach it and grab it. That's not the case. Each claim, each one of you that might have a claim, and I hope it's none of you, would have their own lawsuit. And in Western New York, all the cases are in front of Judge Walter. He's got Erie County, he's got Niagara County, and several others. He's a very fair jurist. He ensures that the calendar moves very quickly, which means that unlike maybe an auto case or something that would take 3-4 years to finish, he'll make sure that that calendar keeps moving. Your claim will be done in about a year. How many of you are familiar with that old board game Clue? It's the whodunit game where you got to figure out, you know, who did it, where, and with what weapon. Well, asbestos lawsuits are really like that. To succeed in an asbestos lawsuit, you need to be able to say who did it, meaning which of the manufacturers of asbestos or sellers or installers caused the illness. Where did it happen? Usually at your plant. And what was the product? So this is very similar to that. And I know this is a long time ago. For some of you, you've been retired a long time. Others of you, if you get a claim, it might be not for you. It might be for a family member. So where does the information come for the lawsuit? Well, that comes, hopefully, if you're healthy and you're still with us, from you, because nobody knows what you did at work better than you. But sometimes that's not going to be available. Someone might be too sick. Someone might have died. Someone might, their health might be such that they really can't help. So what do we do? If you know that old, it's a game show a few years ago, Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? They have the phone a friend. The phone a friend in this litigation is your coworkers. And we're really good at tracking down coworkers. We've been doing this for 30 years. We've represented many of your coworkers. We work very closely with the unions. They're very helpful trying to do that. And there have been cases that when all else fails, with the family's permission, what we'll do is we'll run a newspaper article with the person's picture saying, hey, he worked at Hooker during these years. Do you know them? Do you know them? And your coworkers are great. We'll get 40 phone calls sometimes. Yeah, I know them. And, you know, some people, sometimes they can help, sometimes they can't, but they're there to do that. Last thing is we look at the historical records. Since we got into this litigation early, and Mike Ponterio, who's actually kind of a modest guy, he was the first attorney in the state of New York to get a verdict back in the 80s. So we've been doing this a long time. We've collected lots of records. We've collected the transcripts of all the people who have become ill. And we've searched out the defendants and got what records we can from them. So if you don't know it yourself or through a family member, we'll be able to track it down. Now, I guess so the next topic we need to talk about is, what products are we talking about? Product identification is very important for this litigation. And it really kind of gets broken down into some main categories. Some of you, especially here in Niagara County, asbestos was actually used in the manufacturing process, kind of like a recipe calling for asbestos in a cake. Whatever they were making, they put asbestos in it. I know some of you are from Durez. Durez made something called a molding compound or phenolic resin compound, or sometimes called thermoset plastic. It's a heat-resistant plastic. It's not like those water bottles you have in front of you. You can't melt it over and over again. Once it's molded, it stays molded. It won't melt again. And one of the things they put in there for that reason was asbestos. Now, if you worked at Durez, even though Durez knew about the dangers of asbestos and didn't share it with you, you can't sue them. You got to look to workers' comp. But we do know who they bought the asbestos from that went into that asbestos molding compound. There's companies such as this one here is Asbestos Corp. Limited. There's another one out there by the name of Hedman. There are a few others, and that's who would be the target of the lawsuit. Carborundum. Anybody here work at Carborundum? Okay. Carborundum, you know, one of the things they made it, I believe, in Building 5 on the third floor, is something called these black magic grinding wheels. They're not the kind of grinding wheel you might have down on your workbench, which is grit from all the way from the edge to the middle, and it kind of wears down. These are diamond grinding wheels, and diamonds are expensive. So what they would do is they would just put a thin layer of diamonds on the outside in this part in the middle that was made of that same type of plastic that we talked about at Durez. Durez didn't sell to Carborundum, but we do know who did. There's a company by the name of Planco. There's a company by the name of Union Carbide, and they sold the asbestos molding compound that was used in the manufacture of those grinding wheels. And it's a very dusty and a very dangerous process. I know we're in Niagara County. This is a plant in Buffalo, New York. This is why I am standing in front of you today. My grandfather worked at that plant. My father worked at my plant. My uncles worked at that plant. And what they did is they made rear axles for cars. And part of those rear axles, they put brake shoes. And they ground those. My father ground them. My grandfather ground them. My uncles ground them. I lost an uncle. I lost a grandfather. My mother washed the clothes of my dad, her father, and her then bachelor brothers. And she died of lung cancer for these. So this is another example. That's why I'm here talking to you. This is something that is very important to me, and that's why you're all very important to me. Now, there's other exposures. Another big one is outside contractors were hired for all the places that you worked to come in, and they put up asbestos insulation. This insulation went on pipes. It went on valves, it went on, you know, pumps, it went on tanks, boilers. And most, you know, especially during shutdowns, they'd bring these union insulators from Local 4. They worked from three main companies. There's Niagara Asbestos, which kind of tells you what they did. They actually changed the name of the company to Niagara Insulation later on when they started to get sued for the claims. There's a one down the street, Buffalo Insulation, and another one, McLaughlin Brothers. Those are actually the McLaughlin Brothers there. And they put miles and miles of asbestos pipe covering up at the plants that you worked at. Now, how do you, you're going to say, well, you told me a minute ago, you got to say that I need to identify how I was exposed. Well, places like Hooker and every other place worked at, they did not want their equipment walking out the door with these contractors. So they made them label everything they brought in. All the toolboxes, the carts, the ladders, the scaffolds. In many instances, the trucks were all labeled with the name of the company doing it. So that's usually how people get their information. We have a pretty good indication on it because we have invoices and the like. They'd put up asbestos insulation like this. Two of the bigger ones were Owens Corning. They made a product called Kalo and Johns Manville. And it's round pipe covering. It's cut. It's tore out. It's swept. It's all very dusty. Another contractor you might be familiar with, the local contractor, is a company by the name of Mader. Mader did two things. If you ever looked up at the ceiling at the plant or at a parking garage or something, you're going to see that grayish, fuzzy stuff that's on the ceilings, the beams. It's fireproofing. And they would come in with these big guns, and they'd spray it all over everything. When there were plant workers around doing things like cleaning up and that, so that's one of the things that you might be exposed to. The other thing is they did joint compound work. All the seams and walls like this, they're made smooth with joint compound. And joint compound contained asbestos, and when they put it up, they'd mix it. It was like poured dry cement, like it was, and they'd put water, mix it. Then they'd sand it three or four times, and they'd sweep up. And many times, they would, because this stuff's being done during shutdown periods, they'd bring in people for the shutdowns, you know, people who worked in the plant. Hey, you know, get a broom and clean up after them. So that's another contractor. Probably the most asbestos in any of your plants is the actual equipment that's there. Everything that is hot is steam, whether it's steam or water or chemicals. If it's hot, it's covered in asbestos before 1973. One of the big things that's covered are valves. They would take a cement and put it all over. That picture there I actually took in our old office building in the boiler room. So, I mean, it's not just plants. It's everywhere that they were. You'd have asbestos covered, and they'd come in with a hammer, and they'd knock it off. They'd mix up new stuff. All the valves, they're hooked to the pipes with flanges. They're bolted on. And between the flange is an asbestos gasket. It comes in a sheet. It's 80% asbestos and 20% rubber. It's hot, so that rubber is going to, when you heat it up, it's going to disappear. And what you have is this mess. Kind of looks like a cookie sheet with burnt cookies on it. And they'd come in and they'd use tools like this, scrapers and wire brushes and power brushes, and they create clouds and clouds of dust, which many of you or your loved ones were exposed to. Again, we talked about the old game of Clue. How do you know who made the valves? Well, you know, sometimes it's going to be, you know, if you're a steam fitter or a pipe fitter, these are things you're going to be familiar with. But like everything made in America, I don't care if it's your toaster, your refrigerator, probably you all have cell phones in your pocket or on the table. Everything that's made in America or was made in America had a name on it. The names were cast right into the steel. Companies like Crane or Edward or Grinnell or Powell, and there's more. Pumps, the same thing. If it's hot, it has to be insulated for two reasons. Number one, if it's at ground level and you come by and you put your hand on it, it's like putting your hand on a hot stove. You're going to take half the skin off. So they insulate them. The other thing is they want it to stay hot. You know, if you have something like a pump that's not insulated, it's going to leak heat, and it's going to cool the system, and they didn't want to do that. Same thing with the valves. They have gaskets. Names are cast into them. Companies, some of which were right in Niagara County. Armstrong Pumps, Gould Pumps, Buffalo Pumps. These were products that were all made here, and you can tell what they are based on the names cast right into them or on nameplates. Boilers. If you're any boiler makers out there, covered on the outside with asbestos. They had asbestos seals, gaskets, ropes sealing them, and it's all very. If you worked in a powerhouse, it's all very, very dangerous stuff. this is a kind of a Hooker situation. How many people are from Hooker? Any of you work with acid lines over there? Yeah. The acid pipe, made of asbestos. Like, there's two main companies. There's Bonstrand, there's Havoc. And, you know, they would cut these pipes. They would, just like you see in this picture here, they'd reduce the edge of it with a flapper wheel. And even if you're not a pipe fitter, this stuff was kind of done on shutdowns. And they would bring guys in who didn't want to get laid off. Hey, come grab a broom. And these guys would be cutting this with power saws and grinding it. And people, like even the laborers, were sweeping all that dust up. Kettles. How many Durez people do we have here? Okay, no Durez. Hooker people we have. The chlorinating equipment. They were big, these kettles. They're actually in a Hooker. This is in a Fodler ad. This is your plant. They advertised that we made the Fodler kettles there. They're covered on the outside with asbestos. And that asbestos would get knocked off and replaced. And the people were breathing all that in. Any electricians here? Okay, got one electrician. Things like motor starters, switches, panels, all that black or gray material in there, that's black ebonized asbestos. It's called, sometimes they'll call it just asbestos, but all the materials in there are asbestos. There are things like conveyors and machines, and they shake all day long, and it creates dust. And many of these boxes are sealed up. And what do you do? You come out with an air compressor, you blow it out. When you blow into a box, it all comes back in your face. So there, people are being exposed to that. Now, we're getting near the end because I know you're hungry. Mike talked about the illnesses. What illnesses you can get. You can get mesothelioma, you can get lung cancer, you can get asbestosis and some others. What damages can the actual person with the cancer get in New York? Very, very few people in this room probably have escaped having a close loved one with a cancer of some sort. It might not always be asbestos cancer, but cancer doesn't care who you are, doesn't care how old you are. And it's painful from the cancer itself. If it's not the cancer pain that's getting to you, it is the treatment for it. The treatment for cancer is horrible. They give you chemotherapy. It's a poison. It poisons your entire system in the hope of killing the cancer. That pain is compensable. When you get sick, you're enjoying your retirement years. Things that you like to do. It could be anything. It could be golfing. It could be fishing out in the river. It could be hanging out with your grandchildren or traveling. Whatever it is that makes you you, you cannot do because you're sick. And for that, there is compensation. Now, up the top here, fear of death. I know, some of us are religious, some of us are not, and we all kind of hope that there's something out there beyond waiting for us for our reward. But when you're told that you got cancer, you never forget that moment in your life. You'll remember that day much more than you would say that old thing, everyone knows where they were when they shot Kennedy. You'll remember the cancer diagnosis to the day you die, and it's like getting hit across the chest with a 2x4. There's that wondering, what's going to happen to me? Am I going to be in horrible pain? What's going to happen to my wife or husband, my children when I'm gone? I know all those things are compensable. Now, I know when you said, your husband worked at the plant. It's a little bit different for the people that get left behind, for the widows and the widowers. The damages available to them are rather limited. You're entitled to get your medical expenses reimbursed. Well, most of you are going to be retirees, and you're going to have Medicare. So it's maybe some co-pays. It's not that big of a deal. Funeral expenses. If someone's still working, you get your lost wages. Now, in New York, what don't you get? You don't get compensated for your grief, which is horrible. It's absolutely horrible. There's only three states in this entire union that don't have an award of damages for grief. It's us, it's Alabama, and it's the state of Delaware. And grief is really what you're talking about when you lose someone. I'll give you an example. Say you get a small child. He or she's playing in their yard. Drunk driver comes off over the curb, kills your child instantly. You've lost the one thing that's precious to you in your life. In this state, there is no damage for that. That poor child died instantly. No pain and suffering. Child that big is not working. He has no lost income. It's just horrible. And you know, I've lost a child. It's something I think about every day. It's, you know, some days I can barely get out of bed, and there's no compensation for that. It's the same thing for if you lose your husband. That person's been your partner in many instances for 50 years. You've woke up with and went to bed with that person every day for 50 years. What are you going to do without them? You know, even if it's just, you know, you think of something really good, you want to tell that person that you love, what happened? He's not there. She's not there. Now, hopefully that's going to change. There's a bill that was put out called the New York Grieving Families Act, and it would pay for those type of damages. The grief, the biggest part of your claim, it would pay for it. Now, what's the status of that? It's sitting on the governor's desk. Before the election, she promised she was going to sign that bill. And it hasn't been signed. I put this in here for a reason. That's that old Schoolhouse Rock. That song's been stuck in my head. I want it stuck in your head that it's just a bill. And what I'd like you to do is to contact your governor. Tell your governor that this is important to you. You can do it the old-fashioned way. You can write to the governor. If you go online, using this web page, it'll pull up a form and you'll be able to write to the governor. And if all else fails, talk to me. I'll give you that that number, and I'll make sure you have that so you can contact your governor. And with that, I think I am done. We've answered some of your questions today. But if you have some questions, there's many knowledgeable people here that would be happy to answer them either now or if you like, we're going to be circulating around while you're having lunch. We won't disturb your meal, but if you got a question, just tap one of us on the shoulder and we'll do our darndest to answer your questions. Thank you.